The Red Cross responds to nearly 66,000 disasters every year, most of them house fires. Red Cross President and CEO Gail McGovern says you need to develop an evacuation plan and practice it, especially with your children. It takes just 2 minutes for a home to be engulfed in flames.
Practice those drills. We all think our kids know what to do. They don't. We need to teach them. We have started a large campaign where we're going into vulnerable communities and helping install smoke alarms. Already 92 lives were saved, and 4 of those lives were saved by a 5-year-old girl who remembered what we taught them during these fire drills, and she got her family out. We also have a slew of free apps that people can download onto their smartphones. It's what to do in every kind of disaster you can imagine, how to prepare and how to recover.
To help support all the Red Cross does and to make a financial donation, go to redcross.org. That's redcross.org.
Every day, the men and women of the United States Marine Corps demonstrate their commitment to defend the American way of life. Since 1775, we have served our nation as a force in readiness. From combat operations to humanitarian assistance in every corner of the world. No matter where the mission takes us today, or wherever our country needs us tomorrow, we always remember the land we call home. As Marines, we take a stand for each other, for our nation, for us all, the few, the proud, the Marines.
The following letters were written by our troops.
My dear fellow Americans, I truly appreciate your support. I was starting to wonder if people had forgotten about us over here, but then one of my buddies showed me this website, and now as tears are streaming down my face, I can see for sure that you haven't. Private Emily B., U.S. Army.
It's so heartwarming to see the American people not letting the men and women of the armed forces be forgotten. Your letters make a group of grown men, battle-hardened and gruff, act like a bunch of kids around a Christmas tree. Thanks. Staff Sergeant Matthew H., U.S. Army.
Your support may be the most important thing our troops can carry with them. But don't take our word for it. Take theirs. To show your support, visit americasupportsyou.mil. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Defense and the Ad Council.
On the battlefield, there's a saying America's military men and women live by. Never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Off the battlefield, Wounded Warrior Project operates with the same goal. We leave no warrior behind. Wounded Warrior Project is a nonprofit organization created to help our men and women returning home with the scars of war. Whether those scars are physical or mental, we're here to make sure that they heal. And whether it's helping those with post-traumatic stress disorder live a normal life again, or giving much-needed support to injured warriors and veterans hospitals. Because no one deserves our help more than the men and women who risk their lives to keep us safe. Wounded Warrior Project. We never leave a fallen warrior behind. Ever. Learn more about what we do at woundedwarriorproject.org.
Were you born from 1945 to 1965? People born during these years are 5 times more likely to have hepatitis C. So even if you try to eat right, exercise, and take care of yourself, you could still have hepatitis C, a serious disease that's a leading cause of liver cancer. If you were born from 1945 to 65, you should get a blood test for hepatitis C. Treatments can cure this disease. Talk to your doctor about getting tested. A message from the CDC.
See that cute little dog in the pet store window? Chances are it came from a puppy mill, a breeding facility that forces caged, neglected, and often sick dogs to churn out puppy after puppy to be sold for profit. Meanwhile, millions of wonderful, healthy pets end up in animal shelters. This leads to the killing of more than 9,000 by the end of today. But with one simple choice, you can help. just by deciding to adopt instead of purchase your next pet. Animal shelters are full of amazing pets looking for a home. When you adopt your new best friend, not only are you saving a life, you're taking a stand against puppy mills. When your friends see the smart choice and impact you've made, they adopt their next pet and share with five of their friends, who share with five more. Before long, thousands get involved. Pet stores stop selling dogs from puppy mills, and even more lives are saved. And with your help, we can save them all. Visit bestfriends.org/puppymills to learn more.
Thousands of families affected by disasters, like the recent wildfires, urgently need support. You can help the American Red Cross provide warm meals, shelter, and hope to families when they need it most. Please donate today to Red Cross Disaster Relief to help people affected by disasters, big and small. Go to redcross.org or call 1-800-RED-CROSS today. Your support is critical. We can't do it without you.
The following program is closed captioned for the thinking impaired.
Zinc Media. Feel the power of knowledge.
Welcome to Monday. It is I, your lovable host, Elrod, coming to you live from the Bunker Eye Studio somewhere within the great granite state of New Hampshire. Yes, where the state motto is still live free or die. It is not big government or bust, and I did check, and it did not change over the weekend. Call-in number this Monday, January number 30 in the year of our Lord, 2017, is 603-835-3226. Yes, I know it's already the end of January. Well, technically, tomorrow is the last day, but it's February is upon us, folks. What are you guys going to do for Valentine's Day, St. Valentine's Day? You know, it's amazing how we've changed. Traditions have morphed over the years, and you get and people don't realize what the original holiday or tradition was all about. They seem to forget the origin of this kind of stuff. I bring this up because we do this a lot even to this day. Chuck Schumer is out there over the weekend, claiming he's got teary eyes over Donald Trump's ban of radical Muslims coming from 7 or 8 different countries. Well, depends on the report that you're seeing. This is how bad it is. I'm not even going to mention the publication, but this is how bad it is. This is how ridiculous all this garbage is getting out there. There was a headline. The headline basically read, Trump bans immigration from 8 countries. Then you read the story, and within the first paragraph of the story, they say Donald Trump has banned immigration from 7 nations, and they list the 7 nations. And I counted it again and again and again. And I read the whole story, and there's no mention of another one. They list 7 countries. But the title, the headline of the news article, said 8. Now, somebody's going to say, well, Rod, that's just a minor detail. No, it's not a minor detail. It's called being factual. In other words, the report itself contradicted itself between its first paragraph and its headline. It got one of those two is wrong, which puts the whole story in question. I'm sorry, but I'm not going to share where I found it. But you know, if you're a news junkie, kind of like I have to be for this program, yeah, then you probably already know. I'm not going to spread around the so-called, we got to come up with something else besides fake news. I mean, because now we're changing the meaning of fake news. And now fake news is any kind of news that doesn't agree with your political position. Well, that's fake news. No, it's not. But Chuck Schumer is out there talking about how, you know, this country has, we've never done such a thing before, banning. Can I just say bullshit on that one? And I'm looking at Twitter, and oh, by the way, I got to tell you, I think and this has nothing to do with the creators and the administrators of WeMe.com itself. I know it's a growing site, and I just have to find the groups that are and the people that are a little bit more open. But I got to tell you, I'm getting tired of the censoring over on WeMe. It's just incredible. I mean, people complained, and they're looking for an alternative to Facebook. And these same people that complained over on Facebook and found a different, site like WeMe, which is a very good site as far as, you know, how it looks, the look and feel, how it operates, and that type of thing. But I mean, it's just incredible. The amount of censoring that's going on over there. And it isn't by the WeMe administration. It's by the actual users. Look, I get it. You know, if you have a group or a page, you know, and you get to determine, dictate what's on that page. I fully understand that. You know, I control or own a number of pages across different multiple sites. And yeah, I mean, what you want posted within that group has to fit within the group. You can't have a group about art, for instance. You know, maybe, you know, the art is based on impressionism art, and somebody coming in and giving you, you know, political news. I mean, I get it. You get rid of that because it doesn't fit. But this is not that's not the problem. I mean, You get people that are telling you, well, this is only about news. Well, this is about news on my site. This is about news on my radio show. This is the news. Well, this is only about real news. Oh, so you've never heard my show, but you're going to assume that it's fake news, even though I'm posting about the same damn thing that somebody else just posted about. And you're having a fit because I mentioned that the news is on my radio show? What is this page really about, dude? It's only about news that you want, not about just general basic real news. I don't have time to try to figure out all the nuances that different people might have. Look, if you have an issue with something I post, remove the post. I'm not going to get mad. I'm not going to get upset. I'm not going to go, wah, they removed my post. And if I keep posting something that you don't like, then block me for crying out loud. But don't clutter my inbox with all your bullshit. I don't got time for that. Nobody does. Either you have an open web platform or page, or you don't. And that's fine with me. I don't have to be on your freaking page. But I am not going, if your page is about something specific, and I know I'm posting about something specific, but you don't like it, I don't have time to babysit you. Now, I can see, again, if you're talking about, I don't know, you know, travel. If you like exotic travel, and your page is about an exotic travel in the Caribbean, and I posted something about Canada that is political, yeah, get rid of it and then block me if you want. I got it. But I don't do that. Look, I belong to, you know, pages that I don't own, obviously, of various interests. And I can not post political stuff on woodworking sites. I post, you know, woodworking sites. I post stuff about woodworking. I fully can comprehend and can comply with reasonable demands based on the page and the interest. But don't come at me and tell me, well, this is only about news. When I'm talking about news, you just don't like where I'm directing you to get the full story. Well, too damn bad. Then don't own a page about news. Or you can go ahead and be very limited and narrow-minded, just like the left. That's, you know, that's up to you. It's a free country. But don't paste my inbox in my chat rooms about how you dislike the post. Just get rid of it. If I don't like a post in one of the pages that I own somewhere, I don't go and fill that person's inbox with my dislike of their post and why, and give a dissertation about why I don't like it. I just remove the freaking post. I don't have time to go into all that kind of detail with people. They know. And the funny thing is that when I have removed posts on other pages, not one of those people have ever asked me why. Because they know. They know. And I rarely move a post. It really does have to be a post that does not fit that particular page. Doesn't matter if I like it or not. If I don't like it, it stays. If I do like it, it stays. If it doesn't fit the page, then that's when it gets removed. Plain and simple. I just don't have time to deal with, you know. One of the biggest things I find it very interesting that we have a number of people that are on the left that do this. But you know who's almost just as bad as the left? Is far-right nut job libertarians. And which is really kind of odd, because they're all about freedom of this and freedom of that, and limited government. And then if you ever say something that you believe that they have wrong, oh my God, they just want to shut you down and shut you up like the left. I don't know if libertarians are really today's modern libertarian, because they're not like libertarians of old. Ross Perot would have been construed as a libertarian. The people today are not it's kind of like Democrats. Democrats, they've moved farther and farther to the left. John F. Kennedy would not be considered a Democrat today. He'd be a moderate. Libertarians today, they've moved farther and farther. I don't know which direction they're moving to. I think they're caught between, they're in some sort of alternate dimension. Because on one hand, they claim that they're for ultra-limited government, but then they go out there and they act just like big government statists. I'm confused with today's modern libertarian movement. I really am. I understand what the real libertarians are about, but this libertarian movement that is out there today, I'm confused as hell. I don't get them. Because they claim they're all about liberty, and then you say something that they don't like, and they want to be the first ones to shut you up. Like, wait, that's not what a libertarian's supposed to be about. I know that there are still libertarians out there that are of the original libertarian mindset, and there are some libertarians. Look, I've had this discussion with libertarians before. There are libertarians that listen to this program. And I've had discussions with libertarians in this state. In fact, libertarians have asked me to run on their ticket in a couple of times, and I just said no, because you guys are just, there are too many of you that are co-opting the libertarian movement, the libertarian party in this state, and you've moved to some radicalization, radical point of view, and I don't want to be associated with a bunch of nut jobs. And the Libertarian Party of New Hampshire needs to take its party back from these radical nut jobs, or else you're going to lose. And you're going to lose the movement, you're going to lose your momentum, and you're going to lose people's belief in you. And lo and behold, they didn't take that to heart. They didn't concede that warning that I gave them some 7 or 8 years ago. And now the Libertarian Party in this state is viewed as some extreme right-wing based left-wing thought type of organization. Think of Free Staters. That's not a libertarian movement. But they came in with this libertarian movement that libertarian thought, at least they said they were, the free staters, and people have found the free staters to be, just total nut jobs. And it has turned people off from the libertarian movement. And that's because the libertarians, the real libertarians, failed to keep their party in check. And they, kind of like what the Republicans did after Reagan. Oh, well, let's be more moderate. And the real Republicans failed to fight back and failed to say, well, no, that's not a Republican or conservative ideal, is to move becoming more moderate. That's not. And it nearly destroyed the party. That movement to the center to become more moderate nearly destroyed the Republican Party. Plain and simple. Well, this is the same thing that's happening to libertarians right now. And it's not just happening here in New Hampshire. It's happening all over the country. I'm flabbergasted by this sort of, and I'm not talking about people who have conspiracy theories, because everybody's got a conspiracy theory and everybody's got their favorite ones. By the way, I just noticed that there are some new conspiracy theories on the Curse of Oak Island. Yeah, I've been following that program. And I still say there's something wrong with it. Well, I'm not the only one. There's evidently a bunch of people that think there's something wrong with that show. But in any case, you know, if you don't particularly like something, then understand, you got to understand your history. And because Chuck Schumer looks like a total dweeb. He looks like a total idiot when he's running around talking about, I got tears running down my cheek because we've never done this before. Lady Liberty might as well step down off her stoop. Are you kidding me? This guy obviously doesn't know the history of this country. He doesn't even know the history of his own Democratic Party. We've had Democrats who've, by the way, it wasn't all that long ago that Barack Hussein Obama limited immigration from certain countries in the Middle East. Where is all the protesting then? Where is all that protesting? I don't see anybody protesting Obama. Where's all the protesting for interning Japanese American citizens during World War II? Where's all the protesting when FDR banned Germans and Austrians from entering the country during World War II? Where's all the protest then? And that's not the first time. It's not the only time we've had limitations and bans on immigration. Where was all the uproar from the time when we basically had no general immigration whatsoever for nearly 60 years? Hey, where was all that? Where was, 50 years? Where was all that protesting? Where was Chuck Schumer's tears then? Where were Chuck Schumer's tears when Jimmy Carter banned Iranian immigration? Remember that? Yeah, where were all those tears, that running down cheeks? Where were all the demonstrations, and where were the plethora of petitions to be signed against Jimmy Carter? No, there weren't any, were there? No, because you Democrats are full of hypocritical bullshit, and I'm sick of it.
You're listening to me, your lovable host, L. Rod, here on The Rod Eccles Show.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
It started with a knock, but it wouldn't end there. What happens in the story next, many wouldn't understand, and most wouldn't believe. 5+2=Perfection by Samuel Rosett Jr. is a must-read. The scriptures within are reminders of the ancient past, and yet intriguingly infuses with texts which stand on the edge of the stage of relevancy. Available online at Westbow Press, Amazon, Books A Million, Barnes & Noble, and SamuelRosetteJr.com.
We've all heard of male enhancement, but now there's an expert on true male enhancement in the areas that really count. In Herb Ellis's book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, you'll find answers to questions like, why doesn't she want to have sex? A quick start, quick results workout guide. Plus, what you can do as a side hustle to make money now. With all the great tips in this book, every man can benefit. Get the book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, on Amazon.com.
You know, a couple of weeks ago, a long-haired young person came into our bank and said to me, I bet you won't lend me money to buy an electric guitar. Well, he was making $100 a week, and he was over 18, and I said, I bet you I will lend you money to buy an electric guitar. And I did. So what happens? The punk gets busted for possession of dangerous drugs, and we're out $350. There's one thing about kids nowadays. You don't have to give them credit.
Universal Bank. We trust you. About as far as we can throw you.
Here you are listening to, to the Rod Eccles Show. I am still your lovable host, even though sometimes I get ticked off, but I'm still your lovable host. It's just amazing to me the level of hypocrisy from the left, center left. I mean, even moderate Democrats have obviously shown their hypocrisy. Moderates have shown their hypocrisy. And if you want to call the libertarians the extreme right, well, they've shown their hypocrisy. Maybe it's just the standard operating procedure now is to be a hypocrite. Didn't Christ warn us about hypocrisy and hypocrites? Yeah, I think he did. He said that they were all around us, basically. They were always going to be around us, no matter. I get it. I know. And it's frustrating because when you're trying to live your life and not being a hypocrite about things, and you notice hypocrisy all around you, it gets to be frustrating. It really does. I mean, I get the fact that sometimes something comes across your desk or your purview and you don't like it. It challenges your notion of the truth and your historical basis. I get it. It happens to me on a daily basis. But you have to understand that the truth is the truth, and the truth does not care if you believe it or not. The truth is the truth. It's just going to stand there until one day you're going to be forced to agree with it. Because it is the truth. Just no way around it. And the truth is that the left is full, and the hypocrites are running rampant. I mean, you got the Black Lives Matter who are upset with the Woman's March. And I know this, the Woman's March was last week, but they're upset with them. And the women of the Women's March is telling Black Lives Matter leaders, who are women, to get a life. It's the funniest thing you've ever heard or seen. It's really hilarious. One group being jealous of the other. Well, yeah, let's hand it to those women. Nobody got arrested. And there was no violence in the Women's March. But how about Black Lives Matter protest? Any violence and people getting hurt and arrested there? Well, maybe that's why they got better coverage. Maybe that's why it was more successful than Black Lives Matter, because they didn't destroy any property. I can't believe they're mad at the Women's March because there was no violence in the rest in D.C. Unbelievable.
The Red Cross responds to nearly 66,000 disasters every year, most of them house fires. Red Cross President and CEO Gail McGovern says you need to develop an evacuation plan and practice it, especially with your children. It takes just 2 minutes for a home to be engulfed in flames.
Practice those drills. We all think our kids know what to do. They don't. We need to teach them. We have started a large campaign where we're going into vulnerable communities and helping install smoke alarms. Already 92 lives were saved, and 4 of those lives were saved by a 5-year-old girl who remembered what we taught them during these fire drills, and she got her family out. We also have a slew of free apps that people can download onto their smartphones. It's what to do in every kind of disaster you can imagine, how to prepare and how to recover.
To help support all the Red Cross does and to make a financial donation, go to redcross.org. That's redcross.org.
I'm just so happy my father had a chance to see his kids before he passed. I just want to say thank you.
When her father fell ill, the American Red Cross was able to help get Veronica's brother home from the Navy to speak to his father one last time. It's thanks to your donations that we can connect military families when they need it most. Please donate today at redcross.org.
It's Thursday night, and you're grabbing drinks with some friends. Started off with a pitcher for the table, which quickly becomes two. There's pool. And there's the photo booth.
All right, everybody squeeze in. Say cheese!
Followed naturally by an order of wings. And another.
Can we get some extra ranch sauce?
Then there's the ceremonial nightcap.
So what are we doing this weekend?
And lastly, it's back to the car, which, if you're buzzed... could be the most expensive night of your life. Getting pulled over for buzz driving could cost you around $10,000 in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. Nothing kills a buzz like getting pulled over for buzz driving, because buzz driving is drunk driving. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Every day, the men and women of the United States Marine Corps demonstrate their commitment to defend the American way of life. Since 1775, we have served our nation as a force in readiness. From combat operations to humanitarian assistance in every corner of the world. No matter where the mission takes us today, or wherever our country needs us tomorrow, we always remember the land we call home. As Marines, we take a stand for each other, for our nation, for us all, the few, the proud, the Marines.
I considered suicide so I wouldn't put my family through all the pain.
Many of our warriors are returning home from the battlefield, only to face a new war as they struggle with devastated injuries. At Wounded Warrior Project, we understand. We're there to help.
Even though you think you're broken, you're not. It's the physical and the emotional healing that Wounded Warrior Project provides.
With a gift of just $19 a month, you can join Wounded Warrior Project. You'll help provide critically needed programs and services that rebuild lives.
Beautiful. Woo! There you go, buddy.
The ongoing needs of our wounded and their families will continue for many years to come. Now is the time to show your support. Call now or go online with your gift of just $19 a month, and we'll send you this Wounded Warrior Project blanket.
It made me feel that there's people out there that care about us.
After this event, we can finally maybe start to heal as a family and move forward.
We need your help. The families are hurting.
For many of our wounded heroes, the greatest casualty is being forgotten. That's why your gift of just $19 a month is so important. Please call or go online right now.
Hello, America. It's me, your history. I remember a time when we thumbed our nose in a king's face and sent him packing. And when fascists and emperors talked a little bit too loud, we showed up, tore their cities to the ground, and then rebuilt them just to prove we could. We put men on the moon, we won a Cold War, and we elected fearless leaders who led fearless people. What the hell happened to you, America? Back in my day, we didn't elect a big-eared community organizer. We punched him in the kidney. Maybe it's time you came home, America. Home where you belong.
That is a number that you can use to call here on the Call the Rod Echols show, which is talking to me on the air, on the radio, where, you know, a few people get to hear you when you express your opinion or your concerns. Just a few people. I understand that we have an affiliate who is, you know, these are some, you know, I get numbers from some of the affiliates that broadcast the show. And last week I got some numbers from an affiliate who said that they're, now that they're getting to this program, more than 50,000 listeners per week. They eclipsed that number. So cool. Hey. More people. So, yeah, if you call the show, you know, this is, well, you know, if all you people are out there listening, you should call in the program. I know this is it's a morning program and everybody's. That's the problem. You got a lot of people who are listening to this program, but because they're conservative, they're right of center. It means they're at work. So they probably can't, you know, they probably don't feel free to call in during work hours, but they can listen. They just can't call in. I get it. I know. And of course, you know, a lot of states, if you're a traveling person on the road, you know, a lot of states say that you can't operate your cell phone while you're driving. And I know it's important to get your work done first. But in any case, here we have paper pile. Very, you know, it's a good stack this morning here. Going through some of this stuff. Look, we have some stories here, a bunch of different stories. Today is also the birthday for, who is it? Got Fred? I don't know. How do you pronounce his last name? Fred Korematsu? And he's even trending on Twitter. Now they have the Google meme this morning. Or today for Fred Korematsu. Now, Fred Toyosaburo Korematsu was an American civil rights activist objecting to the internment of Japanese Americans during World War II. Oh, did we forget about the internment of Japanese Americans in World War II? From FDR, a Democrat. Yes, a very Democrat who gave us what? Welfare. Yeah. He introduced welfare to this country. Yeah. So he was out there interning. And there was a lot of people that let me put it bluntly. They died while internment camps. They died while they were interned in internment camps. And the interesting thing is for some, the way for some of them to get out. I mean, look, there were people that lost their entire livelihood, and the government didn't pay them back. I mean, there were Japanese Americans. They were good Japanese Americans. You know, they were American first. Their heritage was Japanese, but they were American first. They had businesses. They owned businesses in Hawaii, California, and other parts of the country. They lost those businesses because they got locked up And many of them never recovered. And the government didn't pay them back. And who put that into place? Oh, it was Democrats. And what was their reasoning? Their reasoning was is because they did not know who was loyal to America and who was loyal to the Japanese emperor, the Empire of Japan. Oh, so there may have been some, you know, terrorists and saboteurs amongst the Japanese immigrants back then. Is that what FDR was afraid of? And they didn't have a way to do extreme vetting, so they had to lock everybody up? Well, And what about Carter? You know, Carter kind of did the same thing with Iranians. Remember the Iranian crisis? And Carter put a, you know, put a block on Iranian immigration. Because there was no way to tell who was sympathetic to Iran versus, now, of course, any Iranians that were in the country, they were not interned or locked up. But people that the Iranians that were here that had visas that expired, no, they had to leave. They didn't get visas renewed back then. They didn't get you know, working papers or the extension on their college studies, their college visas here. They had to go. Under Carter, a lot of Iranians had to leave, and he didn't allow any more in. But I didn't see any massive protest or anybody in the news. I didn't even see the lamestream media talking about how bad an idea that was. We definitely sure as hell didn't have any congressmen or senators on either side of the political aisle talking about what a bad move that was and crying. Oh, no. They didn't have that. There was none of that at all. And there were massive protests that had massive numbers of people at every single protest. The massive number of zero when Obama limited immigration from Iraq for 6 months. That's 180 days. Twice as long as what Trump is proposed for these seven nations to try to figure out who's an enemy of the U.S. and who's a friend of the U.S. Oh, but now we've got massive protests online, offline. He will not divide us. 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 Remember that? Yeah. Look, Trump's not the one dividing us. It's you idiot, hypocritical left that's dividing us. So Democrats can do the banning and limiting and extreme vetting and all that kind of stuff, but and that's okay with the left. But you get a right leaning guy in office who does exactly what the left has already done, and they want to have a hissy fit. They want to have a hissy fit so much so, folks. If you are still buying Starbucks, either in the Starbucks store or in the grocery store, shame on you. Now, I'm not one that normally goes for these whole, you know, boycott types of things, because yeah, I for the most part I don't think that they really work. But this is one that I can get wholeheartedly behind. Now, understand, I happen to really like Starbucks coffee. I have not bought Starbucks in years now. Now, every once in a while, some person who doesn't understand my position on Starbucks will get me a Starbucks gift card. And I have one. I have not used yet. And when I got a hold of this next story here, I promptly got that unused Starbucks gift card, and I cut it up. Now, after I cut it up, I realized, well, the person's already spent their money on it, and there's no way to get the money back. But I'm not going to participate, and I'm making it very well known to all of my inner and outer circle, do not get me anything related to Starbucks. And this is why. I've had it with Starbucks now. I mean, look, we've been through the whole notion where Starbucks is anti-American military. Yeah, fine. We've been through the whole notion that Starbucks is anti-Second Amendment. That's another strike. Well, Here is a third and final one, as far as I'm concerned, and Starbucks can go out of business. Because Starbucks has said, and this is from McClatchy, they are promising to hire 10,000 refugees over the next 5 years. What about hiring all these wonderful people that are American citizens who are currently unemployed? Don't they deserve to have a job? So in other words, Starbucks is going to go ahead and do their own vetting process and hire refugees over American citizens. Now, folks, I can stand with their right to free speech believing that the military might be used for nefarious reasons. I can even stand with their free speech and not wanting firearms in their establishments. That's, you know, we don't own Starbucks. I don't own the Starbucks stores. Get it. Got it. But when you go against the very American people who are buying your freaking overpriced coffee to begin with and tell them, we're not going to hire you if you come to us looking for employment. We're going to hire these people that are coming from outside of our country as refugees. Now, again, I got to ask this question. How is it? When did it ever become the status of a refugee that you're 18, 16, 17, 18 through the age of 30, 35 and you're male? Whatever happened to women and children and old people first? Whatever happened to that? You know, when a ship goes down, women and children and old people first. Able-bodied males, you're going to help the women and children and the invalid and the elderly get off the ship safely before you do. Whatever happened to that? So now you have these fighting age men. I mean, frankly, with all of the refugees, so many of, well, in some estimates, it's 80 to 90% are fighting age males that are the so-called refugees coming out of these countries. These Middle Eastern countries that Trump has now blocked. Well, with all of those men, young men that have fled those countries, there shouldn't be anybody there left to fight. I mean, unless all the women are actually acting like the guys, and the women are actually making up all the armies and the freedom fighters now in the Middle East, because otherwise there's not, and the kids. Otherwise, there shouldn't be any war going on because there shouldn't be any males there. I can see, yeah, it's a bunch of 50 to 80 year olds out there on the battlefield. And I can see it, you got an 80 year old in his walker, you got a cane in one hand and an M16 in the other hand. I'm gonna shoot you down, you enemies! Oh, I can't stand you. Here, take that. Who's defending their countries? Well, it's only one of two things that could possibly be it. The vast majority of those young men are either terrorists themselves or they're cowards. One or the other. Now, look. Somebody attacks your country, you stand and defend it. If you're fighting age, you stand and defend it. Plain and simple, you don't leave your women and children, you don't get on the boat before the women and children do. So Starbucks wants to hire 10,000 of these refugees over the next 5 years. Dateline Washington State. Starbucks says it will hire 10,000 refugees over the next 5 years, a response to President Trump's indefinite suspension of Syrian refugees and temporary travel bans that apply to six other Muslim-majority nations. Howard Schultz, the coffee's retailer's chairman and CEO, said in a letter to employee Sunday that the hiring would apply to stores worldwide and the effort would start in the United States, where the focus would be on hiring immigrants who have served with U.S. troops as interpreters and support personnel. So we have 10,000 of those people? So Starbucks is going to put refugee. Do we have refugees serving in the military? Are they now just going to claim that any immigrant is a refugee? I guess we got Mexican refugees too. Latino refugees, yes. From the southern, when they come across the border, we have. Well, I'm sorry, you just can't make this stuff up. You really can't.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
It started with a knock, but it wouldn't end there. What happens in the story next, many wouldn't understand, and most wouldn't believe. 5+2=Perfection by Samuel Rosette Jr. is a must-read. The scriptures within are reminders of the ancient past, and yet intriguingly infuses with texts which stand on the edge of the stage of relevancy. Available online at Westbow Press, Amazon, Books A Million, Barnes & Noble, and SamuelRosetteJr.com.
We've all heard of male enhancement, but now there's an expert on true male enhancement in the areas that really count. In Herb Ellis's book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, you'll find answers to questions like, why doesn't she want to have sex? A quick start, quick results workout guide, plus what you can do as a side hustle to make money now. With all the great tips in this book, every man can benefit. Get the book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, on Amazon.com.
You know, a couple of weeks ago, a long-haired young person came into our bank and said to me, I bet you won't lend me money to buy an electric guitar. Well, he was making $100 a week, and he was over 18, and I said, I bet you I will lend you money to buy an electric guitar. And I did. So what happens? The punk gets busted for possession of dangerous drugs, and we're out $350. There's one thing about kids nowadays. You don't have to give them credit.
Universal Bank. We trust you. About as far as we can throw you.
You know, there are a lot of other places you can go and get your coffee, your caffeine fix. And frankly, I don't know what's wrong with Americans. They're all about image. And we know this about Starbucks is when Starbucks changed their logo, and they removed their name from the logo. It was just the image. People had a fit. Why would you have a fit over to them changing a logo? Well, you have a fit because you want people to see you drinking Starbucks, and they want the word Starbucks on there so everybody knows that you're drinking Starbucks. Give me a break. It's not a prestige symbol. Well, evidently it is. Prestige symbol to be drinking Starbucks, I guess, because it shows that you can afford it on a daily basis. I don't care about that. In fact, now I see the Starbucks symbol out there, and I bristle a little bit with underneath. I see the little with anger underneath a little bit due to these people not realize what they're supporting. They're more into imagery than reality, and that's a shame. But it happens a lot in this country, and we all get bogged down with some of that kind of stuff. with imagery and it, marketing is good. Look, I'm in the marketing industry. I'm in the advertising biz. I get it. You make something appear to be better than it actually is, and you make it more desirable than it actually should be. I mean, look at cars. I mean, people, you know, what are the big cars? Are Mercedes and Cadillac and, you know, Lexus and what are they really worth paying $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 or more? Or is it just do you really need that so-called luxury in a vehicle? Or is it more about the image that it portrays? Well, for the vast majority of people who buy those kind of vehicles, it's about the image that it portrays. But really, the image, I know rich people have their Bentleys and Rolls Royces and that kind of you know, yesterday I watched on BET, because I was just sitting down for a little while and finally actually had some time to myself, and I was flicking through the cable channels, because I rarely watch cable TV, and Alaska, The Last Frontier was a bunch of reruns that I'd already seen, you know, at least twice, so I wasn't interested in seeing them again, and I came across BET, and they were playing the biopic about New Edition. Now, I happen to like New Edition. Yeah, even the bubblegum pop going all the way back to Candy Girl. They were cute. It was bubblegum. You know, I think they called it bubblegum pop simply because of New Edition. I think they came up. I'm not sure, but I think that's where the term bubblegum pop came from. Was basically, it was because of New Edition. And there were a bunch of, you know, pre-teeny boppers running around at that particular time that were singing this bubbly, you know, kind of pop music. And they called it bubblegum pop. And Candy Girl was you know, was the poster child for that type, for that style of popular music. And so I was watching it. And I know that a lot of this stuff, you know, they have to make it bigger drama than it probably actually was in real life. But I got to say, Bobby Brown was messed up, man. That boy was just messed up. But came across, it was there, one of their original managers, when they went to MCA Records. His big thing was that he had a Rolls. You know, hey, yeah, how's that Rolls Royce treating? Yeah, I like my Rolls. And the guy that was teasing about his Rolls, I guess, had a Rolls Royce too. And he says, well, you should know, it's just like yours. And the other guy, you know, that was teasing the New Edition manager says, no, it's not like mine. Mine's got a fax machine in my Rolls. You don't have a fax machine. Like, who the hell cares? That all of a sudden your Rolls Royce is better? Or your Bentley's better because you have, you know, this is the 80s, so fax machine. Yours is better and more prestigious because you have a fax machine in it? Really? So it's all about image, not about reality. Well, folks, this is part of the problem with the Democrat Party and part of the problem that they're having with Trump. Trump isn't all about image. Trump is about reality and getting things done. And the Democrats are still all about image. And they can't figure this guy out.
America is America because it is so American. The children, they are the future of children. And she loves the children. Diversity is diverse when diversity is diversified. For a future you can see, for a future that brings with it all the hopes of tomorrow, by doing everything we did yesterday, we need a leader, we need a champion, we need her.
Vote for me! It's enough now! Give me it! It's mine! I want it! Just give me it! I want it now!
Stop asking questions
and just give it to her already. Or you're a sexist racist.
Paid for by criminals and idiots for Hillary Clinton, because let's face it, you'd have to be one or the other to vote for this complete monster.
The Red Cross responds to nearly 66,000 disasters every year, most of them house fires. Red Cross President and CEO Gail McGovern says you need to develop an evacuation plan and practice it, especially with your children. It takes just 2 minutes for a home to be engulfed in flames.
Practice those drills. We all think our kids know what to do. They don't. We need to teach them. We have started a large campaign where we're going into vulnerable communities and helping install smoke alarms. Already 92 lives were saved, and 4 of those lives were saved by a 5-year-old girl who remembered what we taught them during these fire drills, and she got her family out. We also have a slew of free apps that people can download onto their smartphones. It's what to do in every kind of disaster you can imagine, how to prepare and how to recover.
To help support all the Red Cross does and to make a financial donation, go to redcross.org. That's redcross.org.
Every day, the men and women of the United States Marine Corps demonstrate their commitment to defend the American way of life. Since 1775, we have served our nation as a force in readiness.
Get some rear security.
From combat operations to humanitarian assistance in every corner of the world. No matter where the mission takes us today, or wherever our country needs us tomorrow, we always remember the land we call home. As Marines, we take a stand for each other, for our nation, for us all. The few, the proud, the Marines.
The following letters were written by our troops.
My dear fellow Americans, I truly appreciate your support. I was starting to wonder if people had forgotten about us over here, but then one of my buddies showed me this website, and now as tears are streaming down my face, I can see for sure that you haven't. Private Emily B., U.S. Army.
It's so heartwarming to see the American people not letting the men and women of the armed forces be forgotten. Your letters make a group of grown men, battle-hardened and gruff, act like a bunch of kids around a Christmas tree. Thanks. Staff Sergeant Matthew H., U.S. Army.
Your support may be the most important thing our troops can carry with them. But don't take our word for it. Take theirs. To show your support, visit americasupportsyou.mil. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Defense and the Ad Council.
On the battlefield, there's a saying America's military men and women live by. Never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Off the battlefield, Wounded Warrior Project operates with the same goal. We leave no warrior behind. Wounded Warrior Project is a nonprofit organization created to help our men and women returning home with the scars of war. Whether those scars are physical or mental, we're here to make sure that they heal. And whether it's helping those with post-traumatic stress disorder live a normal life again, or giving much-needed support to injured warriors and veterans hospitals, because no one deserves our help more than the men and women who risk their lives to keep us safe. Wounded Warrior Project. We never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Learn more about what we do at woundedwarriorproject.org.
Were you born from 1945 to 1965? People born during these years are 5 times more likely to have hepatitis C. So even if you try to eat right, exercise, and take care of yourself, you could still have hepatitis C, a serious disease that's a leading cause of liver cancer. If you were born from 1945 to 65, you should get a blood test for hepatitis C. Treatments can cure this disease. Talk to your doctor about getting tested. A message from the CDC.
See that cute little dog in the pet store window? Chances are it came from a puppy mill, a breeding facility that forces caged, neglected, and often sick dogs to churn out puppy after puppy to be sold for profit. Meanwhile, millions of wonderful, healthy pets end up in animal shelters, This leads to the killing of more than 9,000 by the end of today. But with one simple choice, you can help. Just by deciding to adopt instead of purchase your next pet. Animal shelters are full of amazing pets looking for a home. When you adopt your new best friend, not only are you saving a life, you're taking a stand against puppy mills. When your friends see the smart choice and impact you've made, they adopt their next pet and share with five of their friends, who share with five more. Before long, thousands get involved. Pet stores stop selling dogs from puppy mills, and even more lives are saved. And with your help, we can save them all. Visit bestfriends.org/puppymills to learn more.
Thousands of families affected by disasters, like the recent wildfires, urgently need support. You can help the American Red Cross provide warm meals, shelter, and hope to families when they need it most. Please donate today to Red Cross Disaster Relief to help people affected by disasters, big and small. Go to redcross.org or call 1-800-RED-CROSS today. Your support is critical. We can't do it without you.
You want to know what time it is? It's time to bring the rain.
Zinc Media. Feel the power of knowledge.
L. Rod coming to you live from the Bunker Eye Studio, somewhere within the great granite state of New Hampshire, where the state motto is Live Free or Die. It is not big government or bust. Here it is, Monday, the start of your week, January number 30 in the year of our Lord 2017, almost the end of January. First month of the year, almost down, almost done, almost completed, almost in the history books. As we're heading into the second week of President Trump's tenure, and he's still making waves. I mean, this is going to be he's going to have to. There's going to have to be a lot more done than just executive orders. And look, he's not just sitting by signing executive orders, sitting in the White House. Obviously, this guy's on the move, and he's just. I don't know. When was the last time we had such a workhorse? There is no possible way that these people can, because you know how they used to say about Ronald Reagan. Oh yeah, you know he's got to take his nap, and you know he doesn't get up until 10, and that. And then we've heard about Obama's late starts. His day didn't start late, or didn't start until late in the morning. And hell, I get more done before 9 a.m. than evidently Obama did. I get it. Even presidents have they're human beings. Sometimes presidents have trouble with work ethics. I don't know how much of it is true. It could be just a bunch of partisan talk about Ronald Reagan and Obama. I don't know how much of it's true. I mean, you can kind of believe in on the Obama part because the guy, I don't know how many vacations that man went on and how many golfing trips. What was the final? Anybody know the final tally on Obama playing golf? While he was in office, because weren't his first 2 days and out of office on the golf course? I think so. I don't like golf, so look, has Donald Trump been golfing yet since he's been president? He owns golf courses all over the place. So has he been? If there's one person you would expect to be playing, well, he didn't play golf all that much when he was not president, when he was, the acting as this basically the CEO of the Trump organization. He didn't play massive rounds of golf. I don't know. I would, if I were president, you wouldn't catch me on the golf course because I don't like golf. I wouldn't be golfing. I don't know what would I if what is my what would be my favorite activity to do is I like to roll. Well, I love the roller skate. I haven't been roller skating in a while. Used to be pretty damn good at it. Maybe I'd. Well, the White House is a bowling alley, so maybe I'd spend a lot of time down in the bowling alley. Used to bowl a lot. I haven't been bowling all that much over the past 20 years or so. I just haven't had time. Somebody asked me the other day, would you ever join a bowling league? And I said, no. It was a quick response. I go, wow, that was fast. I said, yeah. The problem is that bowling in a league today, it's a commitment because you're part of a team. And the season is extremely long. I mean, it's usually from what, like September through March or April, or from like October through April or May. It's months and months. It's a long commitment. And I just don't have that. I don't have that kind of free time to. Well, you know, it's only like one night a week. Or the problem with bowling is bowling gets to be very. It can be addictive. I remember one time in my early days and my early 20s, in my late teens and early 20s as an adult. I was on three bowling teams, three different nights, and the kind of money that you got to spend as well. I mean, you got to pay for, your dues basically every week, and the money that was being spent was ridiculous. Thankfully, one of the leagues was what they call a short league. It was only like half a season, like 3 months. And I didn't re-sign up for the next short league. They were money leagues. You know, you won. Well, my team didn't. I think what we ended it. We spent maybe, we probably spent $250 for the whole time, but I think we won like $30. It was a huge number of teams. And you basically bowled against one of the teams. You only bowled against them once in order to get through the rotation. And there was a lot of teams, and it was a short time frame, and it was a cash award. So the first place team, they won like $1,000 or something per player, and there were three men to a team, and you won like $1,000 or something. I can't remember what it was, but it was a bit. But we won like because we finished I think like number 10 or somewhere down there, and we got like $30 or $50 a piece, considering how much we spent, I think we lost out on that one. I don't have time for that anymore. It's a long commitment. I understand that people. I still like to bowl. I mean, I'll go bowling every once in a while. Around here in New England, there's something else that's big. It's called duck pin or candlestick bowling, candle pin bowling, which is very different from regular 10-pin bowling. But and actually, candlepin bowling is the original type of bowling that we got. In 10-pin bowling, what we call 10-pin, the big balls, the big heavy balls, you know, and the big pins, that developed later out of the candlepin or candlestick bowling. But, so candlepin is still very big here in New England. It's not very big outside of New England, I don't think, but it's huge, still very, very big here in New England. In fact, there's a candle pin bowling alley in Concord. There's one in Nashua. There's one in Manchester. And there's a few down in near the Boston area. Yeah, it's still pretty big around here. You'll be hard pressed to find candle pin outside of New England. Really, it's mostly 10 pin. The big, the bigger stuff. They're like the PGA Tour, PBA, excuse me, not PGA, it's golf. PBA, the Pro Bowlers Association Tour. My parents used to watch that on TV. Every Saturday afternoon, it was the Pro Bowlers Tour. One of the things, there are some sports that I find extremely boring watching on TV. Bowling is one of them. I never understood how they get golf. Golf has got to be the most boring thing to watch on TV. I have no idea how anybody watches golf on TV. Tennis is not boring on TV. I mean, tennis can be pretty exciting even on TV. But bowling is, golf is boring. Bowling is boring. And I haven't been to a NASCAR race, but I've been to car races. But NASCAR on TV is boring. Any kind of racing on TV is boring. I mean, this is really part of the. It's kind of like baseball on TV is boring to me. But if you go to a live baseball game, and I've been to a few Red Sox games, even though I'm not a Red Sox fan, I've been to Fenway Park a number of times. Watched it in the stands, and I've watched it in the corporate boxes, and that's the way to watch any game. To tell you the truth, is from a corporate box. But at the baseball field, watching it at the field itself is not boring. Oh, that's great stuff. Baseball on TV is boring. Baseball at the park, not boring. Golf, I don't care what. Golf is boring when you're actually doing it and when it's not frustrating the hell out of you. So, of course, it's going to be boring when you're watching it on TV, at least for me anyway. I have better things to watch than golf. But we haven't seen Trump. I don't think that in the first 100 days, in the first 6 months, you're going to see Trump golfing. I just have that feeling we're not going to see him golf. His work ethic is just, if you were to build a president, as far as, you know, how they work, when they work, where they work, that type of thing, Trump would be your model. I don't care if you like him or not. Well, if you don't like him, then you definitely don't want him to have this kind of work ethic because he's going to outwork everybody. Which is why it's kind of funny to see, because these people still don't understand who he was until the very day that he took office, and they still don't understand who he is. But this is why Obama was trying to, they thought that they were going to overload this guy with stuff. But the guy works so much, so hard, so fast. Just, he's goal-oriented. Get this done, no excuses. That there is no overwhelming of this guy, really. I think they're shocked. I think the left is shocked. I mean, this is shock and awe from President Trump. I think they're in shock and they're in awe by his work ethic and what he's already gotten done. You know, like, wait a minute, this guy should have been bogged down the first 100 days, at least probably more, first 6 months of his presidency. And he's already cleared how much of Obama's crap? This is not normal. It's not normal. Now, the only thing that's going to slow him down or stop him is the GOP. And there's already signs that, well, I got something here about where is it? Boop, 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 boop. The GOP is already having problems with repealing Obamacare. I told you this was going to happen, folks. Because these people, a lot of them are not, they're not into this whole idea of actually repealing it without replacing it. Because they want their own version of Obamacare. They want GOP care. Because they want to show that they're compassionate. They're more compassionate than the Democrats. You know, baloney. Get the freaking government out of the healthcare system. Period. Just get them out. Because they're screwing it up anyway. So just get the hell out of the way. And of course, you know, you're going to have the leftists, including the wonderful leftist. I think a lot of these leftist judges are in for a little shock, too, when it comes to Trump and what he's going to keep doing and trying to get accomplished. But there are judges already ruling against Trump's executive order. Where were they ruling against Obama's executive orders? Do we have many judges ruling against Obama? In fact, a lot of times people were. I know of people that were trying to sue Obama and the Obama administration over executive orders, and judges were blocking it, saying they didn't have any standing. And now all of a sudden, everybody's got standing to sue Trump, right? But nobody got standing to sue Obama, but everybody's got standing to sue Trump over the same damn things. basically. Hey, Canada is reeling from reverse terrorism. Canada is reeling from reverse terrorism, apparent reverse terrorism. Six are dead in a shooting in Quebec City in a mosque in Quebec. And two men have been arrested. Now, isn't this kind of strange? In Canada, of all places, I'm a little bit shocked and amazed by this because it's reversal. And the reversal of how terrible it is that the left is just dumping on these two suspects like you would not believe up in Canada. Because why? Oh, you would have, you know, if you were normal, you would have think that it was terrorist. Oh, and they're wanting to call it terrorism right off the bat. But it's terrorism against terrorist. Yes. Six dead in shooting at a Quebec City mosque. Two men were arrested following last night's shooting at a Quebec City mosque that left six people dead and 18 wounded in what Quebec's premier described as a murderous act directed at a specific community. Well, what the hell does he think Muslims have done? Radical Islamists. What does he think they've done? It's been directed at a specific community too. I don't hear this kind of rhetoric coming out when it's, you know, a radical terrorist that takes out innocent people. I mean, they even go out of their way not to call it radical terrorism, even when a radical Muslim Islamic terrorist killed nearly 50 gay people at a gay bar in Florida. They went out of their way to try to say, well, it wasn't about Muslims. It wasn't Islam that did this, man. And it's unbelievable. So initially it was reported that eight people were wounded, but authorities updated the number to 18 early this morning. Five are still in critical condition. But evidently these, we don't know the reasoning behind it. We don't know who they are yet. But you got to wonder with all the fake hate crimes that have happened here in this country, you got to wonder if this is a fake hate crime that's gone too far. And look, I'm holding out for more info on this. I would not be surprised if that's what actually happens. We learn that this is nothing more than a fake hate crime that went too far on the other side. We'll soon see.
You're listening to The Rod Eccles Show, the coolest, most politically incorrect, conservative black man on the planet.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
It started with a knock, but it wouldn't end there. What happens in the story next, many wouldn't understand, and most wouldn't believe. 5+2=Perfection by Samuel Rosette Jr. is a must-read. The scriptures within are reminders of the ancient past, and yet intriguingly infuses with texts which stand on the edge of the stage of relevancy. Available online at Westbow Press, Amazon, Books A Million, Barnes & Noble, and SamuelRosetteJr.com.
We've all heard of male enhancement.
But now, there's an expert on true male enhancement in the areas that really count. In Herb Ellis's book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, you'll find answers to questions like, why doesn't she want to have sex? A quick start, quick results workout guide. Plus, what you can do as a side hustle to make money now. With all the great tips in this book, every man can benefit. Get the book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, on Amazon.com.
You know, a couple of weeks ago, a long-haired young person came into our bank and said to me, I bet you won't lend me money to buy an electric guitar. Well, he was making $100 a week, and he was over 18, and I said, I bet you I will lend you money to buy an electric guitar. And I did. So what happens? The punk gets busted for possession of dangerous drugs, and we're out $350. There's one thing about kids nowadays. You don't have to give them credit.
Universal Bank. We trust you. About as far as we can throw you.
Six zero three eight three five three two two six is the call-in number. You know, I'm going to be heading to this coming weekend. I will be in the Dallas-Fort Worth area giving a keynote address to the wonderful people down there, a Republican group in that area. Details to follow. So if you're down there, you should, if you're in that area, vicinity, I know that Texas is huge, but if you're in that vicinity, you should come out and give a listen, because you've never seen or heard anything like this as far as a keynote address is concerned. I mean, this is when it gets into politics. I don't stand behind a podium. I hate that. I hate podiums. I don't stand behind podiums. I like being out amongst the people. But speaking of Dallas, there was a loud Arab call to prayer inside the Dallas-Fort Worth airport while Muslims pray and chant Allah. Yeah. Protests erupted at airports across the country following Donald Trump's executive order temporarily banning Muslims from 7 countries from entering the United States. They gathered inside the Dallas-Fort Worth airport with a loud Arabic call to prayer in protest of this ban. However, there are a lot of people that are saying this is not a protest. This is how Muslims show their dominance in a country that they are seeking to take over. Would any Islamic country allow Christians or Jews to gather in an airport and demonstrate like they did in Dallas? No, they wouldn't allow it. Absolutely not. So here they are praying, Muslim call to prayer, and there's a picture of them doing this in a baggage claim area, where obviously people are looking on, waiting to try to get to their you know what I would have done? I would have, this is not the place where you have a call to prayer. This is a freaking airport. I'm sorry, you don't see a bunch of Christians all of a sudden kneeling down and going all hallelujah on everybody at the airport. I would have been stepping over these people, and if anybody would have gotten my way to get to my bags, I would have knocked them the frick out. This is ridiculous that we allow this kind of stuff. This is why there's such a backlash. There is absolutely no reason whatsoever for them to do this here. Except they're trying to slow people down and disrupt everyday Americans' lives. And they do it simply because they don't like the fact that you're a Christian, that you're a non-Muslim. Period. And that you must bow to their will. Well, I'm sorry, that's not going to happen. You get in the public domain and you get in my way, there's going to be a problem. There's not going to be a peaceful call to prayer, Islamic prayer, when I'm around. And this is ridiculous. Where the hell are the protests on this? If these were a bunch of Christians, You know, they'd be shouting out, you know, separation of church and state and all kinds of other crap. Trying to take the group to court to get them banned. They'd be protesting and saying that the airport should be banning these people. But it's an Islamic or a Muslim call to prayer. And all of a sudden, everybody's supposed to go, you know, stand by and go, oh, wow, isn't that cool? No, it's not cool.
The Red Cross responds to nearly 66,000 disasters every year, most of them house fires. Red Cross President and CEO Gail McGovern says you need to develop an evacuation plan and practice it, especially with your children. It takes just 2 minutes for a home to be engulfed in flames.
Practice those drills. We all think our kids know what to do. They don't. We need to teach them. We have started a large campaign where we're going into vulnerable communities and helping install smoke alarms. Already 92 lives were saved, and 4 of those lives were saved by a 5-year-old girl who remembered what we taught them during these fire drills, and she got her family out. We also have a slew of free apps that people can download onto their smartphones. It's what to do in every kind of disaster you can imagine, how to prepare and how to recover.
To help support all the Red Cross does and to make a financial donation, go to redcross.org. That's redcross.org.
I'm just so happy my father had a chance to see his kids before he passed. I just want to say thank you.
When her father fell ill, the American Red Cross was able to help get Veronica's brother home from the Navy to speak to his father one last time. It's thanks to your donations that we can connect military families when they need it most. Please donate today at redcross.org.
It's Thursday night, and you're grabbing drinks with some friends. Started off with a pitcher for the table, which quickly becomes two. There's pool. And there's the photo booth.
All right, everybody squeeze in. Say cheese!
Followed naturally by an order of wings. And another.
Can we get some extra ranch sauce?
Then there's the ceremonial nightcap.
So what are we doing this weekend?
And lastly, it's back to the car, which, if you're buzzed, could be the most expensive night of your life. Getting pulled over for buzz driving could cost you around $10,000 in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. Nothing kills a buzz like getting pulled over for buzz driving, because buzz driving is drunk driving. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Every day, the men and women of the United States Marine Corps demonstrate their commitment to defend the American way of life. Since 1775, we have served our nation as a force in readiness.
Get some rear security.
From combat operations to humanitarian assistance in every corner of the world. No matter where the mission takes us today, or wherever our country needs us tomorrow, we always remember the land we call home. As Marines, we take a stand for each other, for our nation, for us all, the few, the proud, the Marines.
I considered suicide so I wouldn't put my family through all the pain.
Many of our warriors are returning home from the battlefield, only to face a new war as they struggle with devastated injuries. At Wounded Warrior Project, we understand. We're there to help.
Even though you think you're broken, you're not. It's the physical and the emotional healing that Wounded Warrior Project provides.
With a gift of just $19 a month, you can join Wounded Warrior Project. You'll help provide critically needed programs and services that rebuild lives.
Beautiful. There you go, buddy.
The ongoing needs of our wounded and their families will continue for many years to come. Now is the time to show your support. Call now or go online with your gift of just $19 a month, and we'll send you this Wounded Warrior Project blanket.
It made me feel that there's people out there that care about us.
After this event, we can finally maybe start to heal as a family and move forward.
We need your help. The families are hurting.
For many of our wounded heroes, the greatest casualty is being forgotten. That's why your gift of just $19 a month is so important. Please call or go online right now.
I'm not Rod Eccles, and I approve this message.
One of the things that they've been trying to do, this is everything that Obama tried to do before he left office is of the rules for radicals mindset, overwhelm those who stand against you. The problem is that for a regular, ordinary person, they could easily overwhelm them with everything that they tried to do before they left. But Trump is not an ordinary person. So what he's kind of like this superhero that's easily deflecting all these shadow blows that they're throwing. And it's kind of, let me put it to you in terms of you have the martial arts master. And you got this little young upstart that's trying to take on the martial arts master. And the martial arts master isn't even breaking a sweat. In fact, he's got one hand behind his back and he's avoiding all the strikes and kicks and punches and whippings of the upstart with just one hand. And he's barely even moving. Remember The Matrix? When Neo realized how good he was and he was, basically blocking the antivirus, whatever, cop there. He was just throwing all these blows and he was just deflecting them with great ease until he finally kicks him out of the way. So this is the same thing with Trump. We're in an era of massive, 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 massive change. Every industry, pretty much that has been around a while, is currently in the middle or has had a major paradigm shift. The music industry, for example, had a major paradigm shift. Remember Napster and LimeWire? Remember those file sharing networks? Basically, because the music industry was putting out a lot of crap music, nobody wanted to buy an entire album. And it had gotten to the point where it was hard to find a single. Because you had to buy, the tape. Did they have singles? I think they had singles. It was such a waste. There were no more 45s, basically, because the LP had been killed off by the CD. But they didn't want to issue singles on a CD, because that was it was a waste. It really was. So in order to get the songs that you wanted, you end up having to plunk $15, $18, $20, $25 in some cases. Back in the late 90s and early 2000s, $20 to $25 for an album, and when you only wanted one or two songs in the album, so basically you're paying like $10 a song that you like. So that gave rise to Napster. See, the music industry did it to itself. It gave rise to Napster. And people were able to download and share only the songs that they wanted to. And that led to, that was illegal. And that led to things like iTunes being legal. And you had all these artists that thought that they were going to get rich off of suing their fans. Well, it backfired on most of them. And now you have the same thing that's about to happen. Well, you had that happen in music. You know, we had it happen in education. There was a massive change. There are a lot of people now that that don't even leave their home. They get their college education and degree online. They get the, and for a lot less money, which is why I never understood all these college students being so far in debt. Hell, just go online and get your education then, for crying out loud. You can stay at home with mommy and daddy while you're doing it. You don't have to. Well, I mean, I guess it gets rid of all the dorm parties. But there is a paradigm shift happening in colleges right now, in education, higher education. Paradigm shift happened in music. Well, there's also a paradigm shift that's happening in visual entertainment, because we've had the paradigm shift with networks. Now we have to be very clear about what a network is and isn't. Because things that we didn't think were networks before are now somehow networks now. And a lot of these paid for networks are now becoming full-fledged networks where they're producing their own content. Because before you had ABC, CBS, NBC, and you had PBS, and you then came along Fox, and that was basically it. And you had a few outs, you know, upstart, you know, you had the tried to start a new network with what the it's now called Universal, which is now called the CW, I think, right? But you got things like Netflix and Hulu and Amazon and HBO and Showtime. I haven't heard much from the movie channel. Is that still good? Because it for a while there it was. As big, if not, I think Movie Channel did for a while, for a little time, get bigger than HBO, and then HBO came roaring back. They started producing their own stuff, you know, Game of Thrones, you know, Queer as Folk was a big one back in the early 2000s. That really cemented that these non-studios, non-networks get to produce their own content and have it be very, very good and very watchable. And then you started getting these cable channels that weren't networks, they were just channels, and started producing, they took that cue and started producing their own programs as well, beyond reality and stuff, you know, like historical data and that kind of stuff, beyond documentaries. They started producing real content instead of rebroadcasting old content, and that's how you got things like Mad Men and The Walking Dead. And all this paradigm shift put networks on notice that you guys keep producing crap, but these cable and alternate networks are producing stuff that people want to watch. I mean, they're starting to win awards left and right, and it's got the networks thinking, wait, they're not really networks. They are now. Well, this is about to hit the movie industry. As I've said, one of the biggest waste of things, one of the biggest anti-environmental types of industries there are on this planet is not coal, but it is the audio-visual entertainment industry. You know, television shows and movies. Movies for TV, movies for the big screen. Talk about the biggest wasters of energy on the planet, it would be those. And it's not just, you know, that they're hey, you got a bunch of these cars running around. You got a movie about racing, about NASCAR, and you got all these cars running around a circle, burning all that gas to do what? Just to make a movie. Remember the Tom Cruise Days of Thunder? I never watched that movie. In Talladega Nights, the story of Ricky Bobby, I actually thought that was funny. I did see that. But again, it's just a bunch of people running around in a circle for a movie. You're not actually doing a real race. They're faking it. How about the Bourne movies with all the crashing, all the, especially the latest one, crashing the cars and running into buildings and all that kind of, what do they do with that stuff? Well, they have to dismantle it, tear it down, throw it away. A lot of that stuff ends up in a landfill, and some of it has to go back to recycling. But what a waste. Well, now there's something else that has come into play, and it's called human waste, where you get all these people on a movie set standing around doing nothing. I don't know why. I've been on movie sets before, and I tell you this, most of the time is standing around doing nothing. Yeah, I don't even know why it takes so long to do. I can understand sometimes, you know, setting up the stage, but once everything's set up, I don't understand why it takes so long. Well, evidently neither can some other people, because they're starting to figure out that, you know, they can make programming with a lot less of a crew. And if you have any doubt, just take a look at a lot of the productions on YouTube. I'm not talking about the video blogs, the vlogging. Although that's pretty, some of those vlogs are pretty impressive. But I'm talking about the production, these independent production studios now that are producing content on YouTube that is getting massive amounts of views. And they're doing it without all these people running around in these studios. Well, there's a paradigm shift happening in politics as well. You know, everything at some time or another, there's always going to be a paradigm shift. And we have one in politics happening right now as well. And those who don't want the old model to disappear are having a hissy fit. And they're doing old-fashioned things like standing in front of a wall and chanting over and over again, "He will not divide us. He will not divide us. He will not divide us. No, he will not divide us. He will not divide us. No, he will not divide us. He will not." Really? How is that being productive? It's not being productive. You're not doing any kind of work. Look, if you don't like what Donald Trump's doing, why don't you get to work and propose stuff that you think will work? You're not doing that. You're out there rioting and disrupting, and you think you're being cool by standing in front of a camera, Shia, standing there saying, "He will not divide us." Well, it's too late. You already divided us. Obama already divided us. Hillary Clinton already divided us. So no, Donald Trump is not going to divide us, because we've already been divided by the people that you supported. So how about you get off your ass and get off in front of these stupid cameras? You know, oh, wow. You know, Shia LaBeouf can afford to have a video feed. I know some people are thinking, well, he can afford to do it. Well, let me tell you something. Doing that kind of crap is not that expensive anymore. Again, paradigm shifts that happen. All of this technology stuff is relatively inexpensive. All you got to do is buy a camera. Buy a good camcorder, and then you can put it up anywhere. All you need after that is an inexpensive feed. The most expensive part of the whole issue that he's doing is the camera. The video, after that, it's nothing. A few bucks every month to run this thing. For 4 years, he's going to leave it up while Trump's president for the next 4 years. He will not divide us. Oh, big freaking hairy deal. The only other aspect to that kind of nonsense is that he probably has to rent the wall space on the sidewalk in order to do that. And I'm sure they're probably not, you know, if he got to the right place, they're not charging him anything. If they are charging him anything, it's the small token. I mean, it's just ridiculous. But there's a paradigm shift that has happened in politics. And now it's getting to, and the whole world, you know, the Western world is starting to see this. And it's at the point now where it just, people are just tired of the old fashioned politicos. Nothing has changed. They keep promising change after election, after election, after election. Change, change, change. They've got to fix this and we're going to fix that. And they've been saying this for the past 60, 70, 80 years since the end of World War II. We got to change this. We got to change that. This country is no different. Democrats have been saying, yeah, we're going to fix this, got to fix that. And every 4 years, doesn't matter who's president, they come back, you know, the new candidate says, well, I'm going to fix this and I'm going to fix that. Well, that's what the last person who got elected said before you from your party. They were going to fix, and nothing ever got fixed. Well, there's a paradigm shift happening. And people are saying that now that either you fix it or you're out. You do what you promise or you are out. You don't change the stuff that doesn't need to be changed, but you do change the stuff that we tell you that needs to be changed because we want it changed. And the GOP better understand that with the, when they get as they get weak-kneed over the repealing Obamacare. Folks, I get it. It is what it is, and that's what it is, and nothing more.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
It started with a knock, but it wouldn't end there. What happens in the story next, many wouldn't understand, and most wouldn't believe. 5+2=Perfection by Samuel Rosette Jr. is a must-read. The scriptures within are reminders of the ancient past, and yet intriguingly infuses with texts which stand on the edge of the stage of relevancy. Available online at Westbow Press, Amazon, Books A Million, Barnes & Noble, and SamuelRosetteJr.com.
We've all heard of male enhancement, but now there's an expert on true male enhancement in the areas that really count. In Herb Ellis's book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, you'll find answers to questions like, why doesn't she want to have sex? A quick start, quick results workout guide. Plus, what you can do as a side hustle to make money now. With all the great tips in this book, every man can benefit. Get the book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, on Amazon.com.
You know, a couple of weeks ago, a long-haired young person came into our bank and said to me, I bet you won't lend me money to buy an electric guitar. Well, he was making $100 a week, and he was over 18, and I said, I bet you I will lend you money to buy an electric guitar. And I did. So what happens? The punk gets busted for possession of dangerous drugs, and we're out $350. There's one thing about kids nowadays. You don't have to give them credit.
Universal Bank. We trust you. About as far as we can throw you.
So paradigm shifts in this day and age happen at almost on a regular daily basis almost. I mean, news, for instance, newspapers, news stations, the world, not just Americans, but let's just focus on America for a second. You know, people, the music industry, they tried to force, people to buy a whole album for $20 or $25 and a person with only one or two songs were any good on there. So people went to the Napster thing, and that was a paradigm shift that changed, that gave us into these, digital singles for 99 cents to $1.25 or what have you. And people got what they wanted. And they were able to customize their own types of albums a lot easier. Well, the same thing happened with say, the news industry. And look, the news, when all this first started, online news reporting first started, you had the major newspapers and TV outlets, NBC News, ABC News, CBS News, New York Times, LA Times. They thought of the internet is an also-ran. They didn't really care about it. They didn't think people were going to switch. And boy, did people switch. Not only did they switch to going to the internet to get their news, because again, they didn't want a subscription, a full subscription to a newspaper when they only cared about one or two stories per edition that came out. They didn't want the whole damn newspaper. I know, you know, it was only a 50 cents or a buck, but still they didn't want to go to the newsstand in order to get just one or two stories. They can get one or two stories online, in most cases for free. That's what they were looking for. But the big guys didn't pay any attention to it. So the little guys started coming in and started providing this stuff for them, for the reader. And the readers took it to heart. They loved it. And so much so that, what was the newspaper advert? Well, the music industry is not as big as it used to be 20 years ago. It's smaller than it was because of, look, you got all these independent artists out there now that don't have to go through major music studios in order to get their stuff heard. They can throw it up there online, have their own website, do some advertising on MySpace and Facebook and Twitter, and they can get themselves a core following. I read an article a couple of years ago about how if you just had 1,000 core hardcore fans, you could make six figures a year. Music. You just had 1,000 hardcore. In other words, in order to get 1,000 hardcore followers, the way they suggest, if you have 10,000 fans or followers and you make just, you know, 10% of them hardcore followers, and you get 1,000 people out there following you in the music industry, you could have a six-figure, you know, annual, because you could sell the music, all the paraphernalia that goes along with it. You know, they'll come to your mini concerts that you have in certain venues in certain cities. So you could, that's the way they touted it, and it looks like that's the way it's working. So all of that is, the music industry is fragmented. Music industry people don't need to go to the major labels anymore. So the industry is, the traditional industry as we know it, is about half the size it used to be. Newspaper industry has been devastated. I mean, they've had ad revenues as big as $70 billion. Now they're down around $20 to $25 billion. And newspapers are folding and downsizing galore because people don't need to go that old-fashioned route. And these newspapers, they didn't follow the paradigm shift. The music industry didn't follow the paradigm. They all tried to fight it. Here's a lesson for you. If there's a major paradigm shift happening or coming, don't fight it. Embrace it and figure out how to embrace it so you can profit from it. Because every time somebody tries to fight a major paradigm shift, they always lose. They lose every time. I don't know why people do this anymore. They see a paradigm shift, especially in this day and age, and they want to fight it. No, we're going to stay this way. Let me tell you who's next, the movie industry. Movie industry is trying to fight it and say, well, we have all these big, wonderful stars. These big, wonderful stars still think that they're all that their shit don't stink. And they run around talking about political stuff when they shouldn't be talking about it, like Meryl Streep. And their movies aren't making as much as they used to make. Sure, you still get a couple of blockbusters, but nowhere near where it near used to be. And the only reason why their profits, the number of the amount of money that is going in each individual movie keeps going up is because they keep raising the ticket price. If you actually start counting the number of tickets that are sold on average per movie, it's way down. And these people are still trying to fight this paradigm shift. Well, people don't want to be bothered with your bullshit anymore. They just want to be entertained, not listen to all your garbage. And frankly, I can't blame people for that. That's what the paradigm shift, and the paradigm shift is happening in politics too. And you've got the Democrat Party who's been fighting it since 2010, and they keep losing. Keep losing, and they still are fighting the paradigm shift. Trump is the new paradigm shift, people. You better get with the program or you're just going to be out of a job for a long, long time. Just saying.
Have you ever thought to yourself, I'm a leftist elite Hollywood a-hole? If so, good news. The Rod Eccles Hollywood Community College is now open, featuring such courses as Unemployment is Not Paid Vacation. No, Americans don't want to spend $19 for an order of French fries and the ever-popular Shut the Hell Up. Why, just listen to this big-time celebrity endorsement.
I'm not Rosie O'Donnell.
And I think this school's offensive, sexist, and racist.
And I think you're a giant a-hole who needs to shut the hell up. Hey, we teach a course in that. The Rod Eccles Hollywood Community College, where being an a-hole is not a guarantee you'll be an A-student.
The following program is recommended for mature individuals and may contain material unsuitable for morons, cretins, and dishwipes. If you are a moron or a member of the PTL Club, please turn off your radio, because we don't need any more stupid, narrow-minded, pencil-necked geeks who wouldn't know the First Amendment if it came up and bit them on the butt. Thank you.
The Red Cross responds to nearly 66,000 disasters every year, most of them house fires. Red Cross President and CEO Gail McGovern says you need to develop an evacuation plan and practice it, especially with your children. It takes just 2 minutes for a home to be engulfed in flames.
Practice those drills. We all think our kids know what to do. They don't. We need to teach them. We have started a large campaign where we're going into vulnerable communities and helping install smoke alarms. Already 92 lives were saved, and 4 of those lives were saved by a 5-year-old girl who remembered what we taught them during these fire drills, and she got her family out. We also have a slew of free apps that people can download onto their smartphones. It's what to do in every kind of disaster you can imagine, how to prepare and how to recover.
To help support all the Red Cross does and to make a financial donation, go to redcross.org. That's redcross.org.
Every day, the men and women of the United States Marine Corps demonstrate their commitment to defend the American way of life. Since 1775, we have served our nation as a force in readiness. From combat operations to humanitarian assistance in every corner of the world. No matter where the mission takes us today, or wherever our country needs us tomorrow, we always remember the land we call home. As Marines, we take a stand for each other, for our nation, for us all. The few, the proud, the Marines.
The following letters were written by our troops.
My dear fellow Americans, I truly appreciate your support. I was starting to wonder if people had forgotten about us over here, but then one of my buddies showed me this website, and now as tears are streaming down my face, I can see for sure that you haven't. Private Emily B., U.S. Army.
It's so heartwarming to see the American people not letting the men and women of the armed forces be forgotten. Your letters make a group of grown men, battle-hardened and gruff, act like a bunch of kids around a Christmas tree. Thanks. Staff Sergeant Matthew H., U.S. Army.
Your support may be the most important thing our troops can carry with them. But don't take our word for it. Take theirs. To show your support, visit americasupportsyou.mil. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Defense and the Ad Council.
On the battlefield, there's a saying America's military men and women live by. Never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Off the battlefield, Wounded Warrior Project operates with the same goal. We leave no warrior behind. Wounded Warrior Project is a nonprofit organization created to help our men and women returning home with the scars of war. Whether those scars are physical or mental, we're here to make sure that they heal. And whether it's helping those with post-traumatic stress disorder live a normal life again, or giving much-needed support to injured warriors and veterans hospitals, because no one deserves our help more than the men and women who risk their lives to keep us safe. Wounded Warrior Project. We never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Learn more about what we do at woundedwarriorproject.org.
Were you born from 1945 to 1965? People born during these years are 5 times more likely to have hepatitis C. So even if you try to eat right, exercise, and take care of yourself, you could still have hepatitis C.
a serious disease that's a leading cause of liver cancer. If you were born from 1945 to 65, you should get a blood test for hepatitis C. Treatments can cure this disease. Talk to your doctor about getting tested. A message from the CDC.
See that cute little dog in the pet store window? Chances are it came from a puppy mill, a breeding facility that forces caged, neglected, and often sick dogs to churn out puppy after puppy to be sold for profit. Meanwhile, millions of wonderful, healthy pets end up in animal shelters. This leads to the killing of more than 9,000 by the end of today. But with one simple choice, you can help. Just by deciding to adopt instead of purchase your next pet. Animal shelters are full of amazing pets looking for a home. When you adopt your new best friend, not only are you saving a life, you're taking a stand against puppy mills. When your friends see the smart choice and impact you've made, they adopt their next pet and share with five of their friends, who share with five more. Before long, thousands get involved. Pet stores stop selling dogs from puppy mills, and even more lives are saved. And with your help, we can save them all. Visit bestfriends.org/puppymills to learn more.
Thousands of families affected by disasters, like the recent wildfires, urgently need support. You can help the American Red Cross provide warm meals, shelter, and hope to families when they need it most. Please donate today to Red Cross Disaster Relief to help people affected by disasters, big and small. Go to redcross.org or call 1-800-RED-CROSS today. Your support is critical. We can't do it without you.
You want to know what time it is? It's time to bring the rain.
Zinc Media. Feel the power of knowledge.
Yes, indeed. Hour number three already. Fastest 3 hours on Internet Talk Radio is right here on the Rod Eccles Show. Good morning, January number 30 in the year of our Lord 2017, as we broadcast live once again from the Bunker Eye Studio, somewhere within the great granite state of New Hampshire, where the state motto is still live free or die. It is not big government a bust. And, of course, the phone number is, as always, is 603-835-3226. That is the call-in number. Also, yes, CS is reporting that the Gulf leaders comply with Trump's request to set up safe zones on refugees. I actually have that here in the paper pile from this morning. Well, it looks like, you know, this whole notion of, well, why not have safe zones for them there? Then they won't have to come here. Because if all these people want to do is just come here to get away from the violence, have a safe zone, only to go back later when things are all done, well, why do that? Why not keep them in that area so they can more easily be able to go back home and live their lives there that way, the way they want to, instead of having to come here where they get really disrupted and they start disrupting people around them and they don't get to live the way they want to live. And they start doing that crappy stuff like in the Dallas-Fort Worth Airport and having a, look, if you have a call to prayer in the Middle East in the safe zone, nobody's going to bother you on that. Great, fine. But you can't come. Look, Islam is not compatible with our Constitution. Plain and simple, it's not compatible. I don't care if you are an American citizen, you were born and raised here and all that kind of stuff. If you are Islamic, the very documents that you call your Bibles make it very clear it is not compatible with democracy in any form and thus not compatible with our constitutional form of government. It's not compatible. And the so-called radical Islamists have made it very clear that it's not compatible. So I don't want to hear people try to get on me about this stuff. It's not, look, I don't have to defend my position. You've got to defend yours when it's clearly incompatible with the American way of life. So why should we allow it if it's not compatible? What we want is people to come here to be compatible with us, to blend in with us, to meld in this great melting pot called America, so we can produce a far stronger and interesting culture and country. I mean, no place else in the world. Look, yeah, I know. I've been to France and in Iceland. They don't have... Yeah, we it kind of interesting. We ended up going to a Mexican restaurant in Paris, but it was supposed to be a Texas. I mean, they can't get it right. It wasn't Midwestern food, and it really wasn't very good Mexican food. But we should have known better. When you're in, well, this is what the Parisians eat, and they think it's Mexican. You know, kind of like Americans when they go to Taco Bell and think they're eating Mexican. Well, not really. But this wasn't fast food in Paris to eat Mexican. You know, it wasn't a Taco Bell version. No, it was a sit-down version. It was like a La Hacienda or something. And it was very off. The restaurant was called Indiana. Yeah, Indiana isn't even near the southwest part, but you know, hey, that's what it was called. It was the restaurant was called Indiana. It had Texas decor, basically something that you'd find in Texas or maybe even Arizona. So it was that kind of decor, but it was supposed to be Mexican food. They just had it all wrong. I'm not saying it was horrible. But it's, if you're an American or even, you know, a Latino, you're not, and you're in Paris, don't go to Indiana. I'm just, the restaurant, I'm sorry, folks. That was funny. We did go, and we end up having some French wine with our Parisian Mexican fare. But yeah, there you have it. And I can't believe that was over a year ago now that we actually went to Paris. Would like to go back someday. Yeah, would like to go back. But yeah, we all think that we know what the deal is because we have it here. But we have to understand that when you bring it here and we have this giant melting pot, that it produces something that is different from the original. Some cases it's better. Sometimes it's not better, but it's not worse. And then on rare occasions it is worse, but it doesn't stick around very long. Not to pick on Taco Bell, but places like Taco Bell, is it real Mexican fare? Well, most people would say no. It's not real Mexican food. But is it worse? Well, no, not really. I mean, it's good for what it is. It was something that was developed and came about out of the culture, the Americanization of Mexican food, and we've done that with just about every ethnic food. We take the basic essence of Asian cuisine, and we stick it in the mall. And we call it Panda Express, and we say, yeah, we're eating Chinese food. We're not really eating real Chinese food. I've been to restaurants that serve real Chinese food, and it's usually not the kind of stuff that you can get at a place similar to or at a Panda Express. Just, I know Panda Express is a brand name, but restaurant name, and I'm not just picking on Panda Express, but is Panda Express bad? No, I happen to like Panda Express. I like Americanized Chinese fast food. I think it's delicious. Now, whether or not it's good for me, you know, I don't eat it every day. But you know, it's okay for what it is. Will you find that kind of stuff in China? Probably not. Although I've never been to China, so I can't honestly say. But then I've seen, you've seen TV shows and movies and news reels and stuff like that from China. I don't see that kind of stuff. It's a different kind of Chinese fast food that they have there that we have here. But we have it here. Is this stuff better than Chinese food? No. Is it worse? Not really. Just depends on what you want. So we can take stuff and not necessarily make it any better, but we can make it into something different while trying to adhere to the old-fashioned standard. So, you've got Taco Bell type of Mexican food. Is it better than authentic Mexican food? No, but it's something that's Americanized and it develops into our culture. And we get this because we get, not just Mexicans who come here legally, but Latinos from all over Latin America who come here legally. And not only do we not just get Chinese people who come here legally, we get people all over from Eastern Asia that come here legally. And they contribute to our culture. They don't try to stand apart from it. Now, when you have people that want to stand apart from the culture that they're moving into, that's when you start to have problems. When you start to have Latinos who move here who don't want to integrate, who don't want to learn to speak English, you want to move into enclaves with nothing but other Spanish-speaking people that are similar to them. Mexicans want to hang around with nothing but Mexicans, and Guatemalans want to hang around with nothing but other Guatemalans and other Central American countries, and you get the Brazilians and Venezuelans that want to hang out together. I mean, that's when you start having problems. But if you integrate, you're not going to have a problem, which is why we've been able to live together. All these ethnic backgrounds, all these people from all over the world have been able to come to the United States to live together in pieces because we've been able to meld all our different cultures together into one unique culture called American culture. And then you have people like Islamists who come from the Middle East who do not want to capitulate to this idea of the melting pot, who do not want to integrate, and who want to do nothing more than to bring their entire culture, their entire country here and force it on the rest of us. That's not going to work. That's when you get ethnic strife and ethnic problems. It's not diversity. It's problems. It's strife. It's violence. That's what happens when you have those who do not want to integrate into the culture that they're moving to. If you don't want to integrate into that culture, then don't move there. If I don't want to integrate into Parisian or French culture, why the hell would I move there? And you have some people that want to move to France. They want to move to Paris. Great, but you got to be able and willing to integrate and to meld into that culture. You don't have a right to go into another country and another culture and demand that they recognize and establish your culture from your old country. If you like your old culture that much, then go back home. Plain and simple. Now, if you want to add to that culture, then sure, go ahead and move to Paris and open a restaurant with Southwestern cuisine. Give them the real or open a real New York City deli. I didn't see one of those there, by the way, in Paris. I'm not saying there wasn't one. We just didn't see one. But hey, there's an opportunity. But you know what's going to happen is that in order for you to be a viable business, you're going to have to sort of change your deli, your New York style deli a little bit to fit the Parisian lifestyle. You might, in some places where you use bagels, you might have to use croissant. That's how it works. Because they may not like bagels. You're not gonna do very well unless you, hey, if Taco Bell decided to stick with the real authentic taco, they might not have been as successful as they are. They had to change it a little bit. And that's fine. They had to bring it into the American culture. And that's fine too. So I mean, look, you can't stand outside of the of somebody else's culture and demand that culture bend to you. And that's what we've had far too often with all of these Muslims coming into Islamists coming into Western culture. They don't want to meld or blend. They want to take over.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
It started with a knock, but it wouldn't end there. What happens in the story next, many wouldn't understand, and most wouldn't believe. 5+2=Perfection by Samuel Rosette Jr. is a must-read. The scriptures within are reminders of the ancient past, and yet intriguingly infuses with texts which stand on the edge of the stage of relevancy. Available online at Westbow Press, Amazon, Books A Million, Barnes & Noble, and SamuelRosetteJr.com.
We've all heard of male enhancement, but now there's an expert on true male enhancement in the areas that really count. In Herb Ellis's book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, you'll find answers to questions like, why doesn't she want to have sex? A quick start, quick results workout guide. Plus, what you can do as a side hustle to make money now. With all the great tips in this book, every man can benefit. Get the book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, on Amazon.com.
You know, a couple of weeks ago, a long-haired young person came into our bank and said to me, I bet you won't lend me money to buy an electric guitar. Well, he was making $100 a week, and he was over 18, and I said, I bet you I will lend you money to buy an electric guitar. And I did. So what happens? The punk gets busted for possession of dangerous drugs, and we're out $350. There's one thing about kids nowadays. You don't have to give them credit.
Universal Bank, we trust you about as far as we can throw you.
Well, the dream's in the ditch. Well, it looks like Trump has put the left's dream in the ditch a little bit by a maneuver that he did right after his inauguration. And there's somebody on Twitter who's having a fit with this. Now, at first I thought maybe that they were all for Trump, but then I realized that no, that they're called the Resisterhood. And they don't like that the fact that Trump evidently filed with the FEC on January 20th of 2017, his intent to be a candidate for the 2020 election cycle for re-election. And the Resisterhood on Twitter basically pointed out that this is not normal. It's not normal. Obama filed for 2012 re-election in April 2011. He did this after the midterms. Incumbent declaring before midterms is unheard of. Told you, Trump is—he's instituting a paradigm shift that these people are just—they're flabbergasted by, and all they want to do, instead of embracing and going along with the change, they want to fight it. You can never stop a paradigm shift. If it is a real paradigm shift, and Trump is one, you can't stop it. But they're going to try to fight against it. And they're going to try to fight. Now the resisterhood is saying that there are several major implications. If officially a candidate, he can use his candidate status to curry favor with PACs. Oh, my goodness. Businesses. Oh, my goodness. And other organizations. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, we can't have that. We can't have the president actually being, you know, aligned with other people in the country. No, that's not possible. That's not the way it's supposed to be done. So he's acting as candidate Trump and not President Trump, which is also that's what the resisterhood is saying, but it's actually not true because candidate Trump cannot do what President Trump does. Because one is president and the other is, you know, wannabe president. Evidently, according to resisterhood, it also completely changes how nonprofits can handle, can deal with him. 501c3s, for instance, cannot campaign or risk losing nonprofit status. Well, good, because they're not in it anyway for being nonprofit. They're partisan. They're full of hacks. It's nothing but hackery. It's money laundering for the Democrat Party. So they should lose their status, you know, like many of the Tea Party organizations couldn't get 501c3 status because the IRS blocked it. It means that these groups cannot speak negatively about him. I don't know why she would say that, the resistor, because of course they can. Of course they can speak. They never once was that going to be stopped. Oh, now, but they'll be able to be more easily identified and during this whole process, because they just can't hide behind, you know, 501c3 status that they can do and say what they want to a particular politician without, you know, some sort of ramifications. Because before, you know, they could run rampant and do whatever the hell they wanted. Soros wanted to. I got some information here on Soros, too, for you anti-Soros people. Soros. Soros is currently backing efforts to thwart the Trump refugee temporary ban program. Yeah, I got it. I got it right here in the good old paper pile about good old George Soros. He's lawyers. Well, there's a bunch of different things happening, and a lot of these people are being backed by Soros. Soros' bankrolling effort to stop Trump's temporary refugee halt order. And we already have some judges already ruling against Trump executive orders, but you have some people in national security agencies at airports who are ignoring some judges' orders. The flurry of anguish news stories and protests surrounding President Trump's executive action temporarily suspended. Over the weekend, I've heard from people, liberals, who are just all aghast about the Trump that, I can't believe Trump's doing. Trump's just, you know, he's just trying to divide us, and Trump is doing this. Trump's terrible. Trump's terrible. Hey, you know Obama did the same thing? What? Yeah, in other words, these people don't know. And they don't know because all they're doing is watching the lamestream media. The lamestream media has been lying to them for the past 8 years, at least, about Obama. So when you tell them that Obama back in 2011 banned and limited Iraqi immigration, remind them of it, they say, well, I didn't know that. Well, that doesn't mean that Trump's doing the right thing. Well, wait. Are you not going to say Obama did the wrong thing? Well, no, because I don't know. What do you mean you don't? You don't know? I just told you. Here's the problem. Trump fits their limited narrative. Obama doing the same thing doesn't fit their limited narrative. Even though they claim that they hate this idea that Trump put forth, which Trump didn't put forth, It's what Obama already did. He just expanded it. And now they're all a flutter. They don't like it. Well, Soros is saying is now out there. He's financing some lawyers rather than a complete Muslim ban as promised during the campaign. Trump's executive order contains moderate refugee restrictions similar to those that have been implemented by President Obama. If reports are true that that restrictions are being applied even to green card holders, and that's an unfortunate misapplication of the law that they will soon likely be No, it's not a miscalculation of the law. If it's a green card holder, shouldn't be here anymore. If they look, you know, Trump said if their green cards expired, they should leave.
The Red Cross responds to nearly 66,000 disasters every year, most of them house fires. Red Cross President and CEO Gail McGovern says you need to develop an evacuation plan and practice it, especially with your children. It takes just 2 minutes for a home to be engulfed in flames.
Practice those drills. We all think our kids know what to do. They don't. We need to teach them. We have started a large campaign where we're going into vulnerable communities and helping install smoke alarms. Already 92 lives were saved, and 4 of those lives were saved by a 5-year-old girl who remembered what we taught them during these fire drills, and she got her family out. We also have a slew of free apps that people can download onto their smartphones. It's what to do in every kind of disaster you can imagine, how to prepare and how to recover.
To help support all the Red Cross does and to make a financial donation, go to redcross.org. That's redcross.org.
I'm just so happy my father had a chance to see his kids before he passed. I just want to say thank you.
When her father fell ill, the American Red Cross was able to help get Veronica's brother home from the Navy to speak to his father one last time. It's thanks to your donations that we can connect military families when they need it most. Please donate today at redcross.org.
It's Thursday night, and you're grabbing drinks with some friends. Started off with a pitcher for the table, which quickly becomes two. There's pool. And there's the photo booth.
All right, everybody squeeze in. Say cheese!
Followed naturally by an order of wings. And another.
Can we get some extra ranch sauce?
Then there's the ceremonial nightcap.
So what are we doing this weekend?
And lastly, it's back to the car, which, if you're buzzed...
608 to 90-10-4.
...could be the most expensive night of your life. Getting pulled over for buzz driving could cost you around $10,000 in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. Nothing kills a buzz like getting pulled over for buzz driving, because buzz driving is drunk driving. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Every day, the men and women of the United States Marine Corps demonstrate their commitment to defend the American way of life. Since 1775, we have served our nation as a force in readiness.
Get some rear security.
From combat operations to humanitarian assistance in every corner of the world. No matter where the mission takes us today, or wherever our country needs us tomorrow, we always remember the land we call home. As Marines, we take a stand for each other, for our nation, for us all. The few, the proud, the Marines.
I considered suicide so I wouldn't put my family through all the pain.
Many of our warriors are returning home from the battlefield, only to face a new war as they struggle with devastated injuries. At Wounded Warrior Project, we understand. We're there to help.
Even though you think you're broken, you're not. It's the physical and the emotional healing that Wounded Warrior Project provides.
With a gift of just $19 a month, you can join Wounded Warrior Project. You'll help provide critically needed programs and services that rebuild lives.
Beautiful. Woo! There you go, buddy.
The ongoing needs of our wounded and their families will continue for many years to come. Now is the time to show your support. Call now or go online with your gift of just $19 a month, and we'll send you this Wounded Warrior Project blanket.
It made me feel that there's people out there that care about us.
After this event, we can finally maybe start to heal as a family and move forward.
We need your help. The families are hurting.
For many of our wounded heroes, the greatest casualty is being forgotten. That's why your gift of just $19 a month is so important. Please call or go online right now.
Bring the rain.
George Soros is out there backing some lawyers who are then in turn going out and trying to sue the Trump administration. And U.S. judge limits Trump immigration order. Some officials ignore the ruling. This is from Yahoo News, by the way, reporting, so take it for what it's worth from Yahoo. U.S. judges in at least five states blocked federal authorities from enforcing President Donald Trump's executive order restricting immigration from seven Muslim countries. However, lawyers representing people covered by the order said some authorities were unwilling on Sunday to follow the judge's rulings. And this is where there's an issue. Individual lower court cannot set aside a president's orders. That's like the a judge saying, well, you know, he calls up the National Guard, and the judge says, no, you can't do that. Yeah, you can. It's going to take Congress or the Supreme Court in order to do something about the president. That would be constitutional, not some individual fiefdom little. You can't have this is a national policy. And it is a purveyance of the federal government in order to protect the borders. An airport is a border no matter where it is. It's an international border. Constitutionally speaking, a little judge cannot block the president from protecting the borders that he is constitutionally obligated to do. Now, he's not violating any citizens' rights by doing this because people who are not citizens don't have the same rights that citizens do. That's also constitutionally accurate. Now, judges in California, Massachusetts, Virginia, and Washington State, of course it'd be those states, each home to international airports, issued their rulings after a similar order was issued on Saturday night by U.S. District Judge Ann Donnelly in New York's Brooklyn Borough. Donnelly had ruled in a lawsuit by two men from Iraq being held at JFK International Airport. While none of the rulings struck down Friday's executive order by the new Republican president, the growing number of them could complicate the administration's effort to enforce it. No, it doesn't. He just has to enforce it. And he says anybody that is under the purveyance of the federal government, of the president, who actually is their boss, like the Homeland Security and the TSA, they will do as he's directed. Plain and simple. And frankly, I think it's about time we start putting some of these judges in their place. They are not the last purveyors of law in this country. I think the Constitution is pretty clear on the limits of their reach. And these people think that they can write law? No, they cannot. And this is what they're trying to do. Once again, The bench, you cannot adjudicate. All you can do is adjudicate. You cannot write law from the bench. You cannot say, well, you know, hey, you got to put this in it or that. No, that is not your job, court system. Plain and simple. So this whole notion that they can tell the president how he's to do his job is not constitutional. And these people need to be put in their place. Maybe it's time just the entire federal government just has term limits. Everybody, including the Supreme Court justices. I'm not sure I'm actually there yet, but yeah, everybody needs to have a term limit. Everybody in government needs to have, you know, every elected official needs to have a term limit. I don't care if it's local or if it's state or if it's federal. We've got to end this nonsense of people being appointed for life at certain positions that then begin to think because they're untouchable, they're unaccountable, they can start doing whatever the hell they please. I think it's time that we start making all of these appointed and elected officials, they have mandatory maximum caps. And maybe we should just do something that's even a little bit more radical and just say, you know what? There is a lifetime cap to how many years you can serve in government. So in other words, you don't get these idiots that just, well, okay, let's say two terms is the norm. Well, you don't have these yahoos deciding, well, you know what? I'm going to start at the bottom, serve two terms there, then I'm going to move up to the county level and serve two terms there, and then move up to the state level and serve two terms there, and then move up to the federal level and serve two terms in the House and then serve two terms in the Senate. So by the time you're all said and done, by the time these people move up the ranks, they're still in power for 30 or 40 years. That's got to be eliminated. It's got to be eliminated somehow. We've got it. We've got to. I'm a person that hasn't always been for term limits. I've said that, you know, the American people, the voter, is the term limit. But there is so much corruption. And these people, they write laws and bend the rules in the incumbent's favor or whoever is favored to be in that position, to win that position. They're the ones that get all the favors. They're the ones that get all the preferential coverage and the preferential dollars. And those are the ones that seem to get away with doing illegal activity while everybody else around them who's done the same thing gets thrown in jail. So maybe we need to have not only individual term limits for each particular position, but maybe maximum lifetime term limits. So at some point, you have to go back to the private sector, which means if you're going to be in the private sector, you might not be so eager to try to overly regulate the private sector or overly adjudicate against the private sector, because you're going to have to be in it at some point. Right now, most of these people, they feel that they don't have to be in the private sector. They can do anything and everything they possibly can to stay out of it by, you know, getting elected and then getting appointed and then reappointed or reelected over and over and over again. But if we can put a lifetime cap on some of these people in some of these positions, that might take a lot of this stupidity out of governance. Because these people will have to, once again, at some point in their lives, they know they're going to have to live in the private sector. They're not going to have the preferential treatment of being in government anymore. We need something like that. I mean, I know that sounds radical to some people, but hey, there's a paradigm shift, and there needs to be a paradigm shift in how we're a nation of nearly 320 million people. There's a lot of people that could be qualified to run for public office at different levels, from local all the way up to Fed. But many of them, myself included, will not do so because of what one has to do in order to unseat an incumbent. What you have to endure and go through. Simply so because those incumbents are not limited in their ability to stay in that position. So they can do and get away with all kinds of things that a challenger cannot get away with. Plain and simple. And if an incumbent can't be an incumbent anymore, well, then that means the media, well, they're going to have to pick another favorite. Sure, they can still pick a favorite, but it's going to be a lot less than the standing incumbent. And if we make laws where these people, if they're in an elected position, they cannot be appointed to a government position. Sure, maybe we can have waivers, but the waiver has to be, you know, there has to be certain limitations with the waivers as well. We can revamp this whole thing where these people just can't, you know, well, if I can't be elected anymore, I just get my buddy to appoint me to this position. And these appointments can't be lifetime either. They just can't be. We got to put limits on them too. And you cannot have been an elected official and then immediately go into an appointed position in government at any level. You got to go back to the privates. It's very easy to say you don't have to say that, you know, list everything out. All you have to do is say anyone who is an elected official, and whether or not that they have to leave that their post. Either by term limit or by losing an election. They cannot be appointed to another government position for so many years. Just give them 4 years. They must return to the private sector for 4 years minimum. And the only way they can be appointed and get a waiver is if it has to do with national security and there is nobody else available that has equal or better qualifications. That's pretty easy to say. You cannot say, well, somebody else doesn't have equal qualifications. That's hard to do. In any state. So you say you got to be out of go. If you term limit, here's the caveat limitation. If you term limit out, say you're in the House, and you got two term limits. So you served your second term limit. You can't run for House position anymore. So that means you got to run for the Senate position. Well, you can go from House to Senate. Well, because you're being elected. That's different. But you can't say go from the House and say, okay, I don't want to run, or I lost my bid for re-election or get elected in the Senate. So appoint me to some sort of government position. Nope, can't do it. You cannot be appointed. Now, you can come back in 2 or 4 years or 6 years and run for office again when that particular seat is up for election. I'm not going to say you can't, as long as you haven't capped out. Let's put a cap of 20 years max outside of being president. 20 years is your max for an elected position in any form of government, from local to fed. So you're going to have, within your working lifetime, you're going to have to be in the private sector. Does anybody else agree with that? I mean, is that being too limiting, too harsh on our elected officials? Is that limiting the voter to, I don't know. I think it opens up the voter to far more candidates, and it opens the voter up the choice to the voter more. So now you have more choices and more opportunity for change. Is that a problem? Do you think that limiting, putting a lifetime cap or putting term limits on elected officials and preventing elected officials from a certain period of time after leaving an elected post from being appointed, that do you think it's a bad idea to force elected officials to spend at least part of their adult lifetime in the private sector? Is that a bad thing for public policymakers? I don't think so. I think that's it's the same with judges. Judges should not get lifetime appointments. Now, I understand why they did it in certain federal courts and for the Supreme Court, because it takes a politics. Supposedly, it removes as much of the politics out of it as possible. But it gets to the point where these people are on the court or they're on the bench for 40 or 50 years. And they're unaccountable. So it gets to the point where It no longer works the way it was originally set because there's too much corruption and there's no accountability. So we need to bring back accountability not only to our elected officials, but to our appointed officials. And appointed officials should not be appointed for life. There should be 10-year limits. Now, maybe, you know, maybe the Supreme Court, you can be limited to, 10 years. That pretty much means that once you get you got to go through another president. I'll even take an odd number, like 15 years. Shouldn't be any more than 20. 10 to 15 years for the Supreme Court, even. I know it can work. It can work against us. But it's a little bit more tricky for the Supreme Court. I get it because, you know, you could, like now Trump appoint a very prominent and staunch conservative to the bench, and they could be on the bench for the next 30 or 40 years. I get it. But at the same time, it could go the other way, and just like we have seen, put liberals on the bench, and it can go the other way. So I know the Supreme Court is probably the toughest one to try to figure out a fair balance without getting overly political is possible in the Supreme Court. But for the rest of the elected positions, I mean, it's not a question the question just because it becomes, well, how many terms do we limit you? You know, because in the House, what, you're only in there 2 years. So do we limit you to two terms, which is only 4 years? Well, in the Senate, for one term, you got six. So should we say 3 terms? 6 years max in the House? 12 years max in the Senate? It still gives you, 18 years. So, guess it means you can't. Well, guess it means you can't be. You can't be a governor in some states and then go to the national level. You could here, because our governor is only elected for 2-year terms, so that could fill it out for you. But it's not a bad idea. I don't think it's a bad idea to force these people to go back into private life, private sector. And not just always be in government. We get a lot less of this crap, the unaccountable crap, that's for sure.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
It started with a knock, but it wouldn't end there. What happens in the story next, many wouldn't understand, and most wouldn't believe. 5+2=Perfection by Samuel Rosette Jr. is a must-read. The scriptures within are reminders of the ancient past, and yet intriguingly infuses with texts which stand on the edge of the stage of relevancy. Available online at Westbow Press, Amazon, Books A Million, Barnes & Noble, and SamuelRosetteJr.com.
We've all heard of male enhancement, but now there's an expert on true male enhancement in the areas that really count. In Herb Ellis's book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, you'll find answers to questions like, why doesn't she want to have sex? A quick start, quick results workout guide. Plus, what you can do as a side hustle to make money now. With all the great tips in this book, every man can benefit. Get the book, Husband 2.0, Real Male Enhancement, on Amazon.com.
You know, a couple of weeks ago, a long-haired young person came into our bank and said to me, "I bet you won't lend me money to buy an electric guitar." Well, he was making $100 a week, and he was over 18, and I said, "I bet you I will lend you money to buy an electric guitar." And I did. So what happens? The punk gets busted for possession of dangerous drugs, and we're out $350. There's one thing about kids nowadays. You don't have to give them credit.
Universal Bank. We trust you. About as far as we can throw you.
Couple of final notes. One is about Malia Obama. That would be Barack Hussein Obama and Michelle Maybelle Obama's eldest daughter. And I know there are some people who are saying that they're not really their kids, they're rented children. You just don't rent a kid, sorry. I'm not going to say that. But Malia Obama ditches Palm Springs for the Sundance Pipeline protest. Now, if you remember, I told you last week that the Standing Rock Dakota Sioux asked all the protesters to leave. They asked him to leave. So what does Malia do this weekend? Instead of, you know, encouraging all her fellow liberal friends to leave, she goes there. Well, here's from the Detroit Free Press, and this is how they start out how they write this. It's kind of interesting how they write this. If Malia Obama's first week as former first daughter is anything to go by, the 18-year-old's re-entry into civilian life appears to be going smoothly. Take, for example, her trip to Sundance Film Festival. On Monday, she attended an event supporting the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe's protest against the Dakota Access Pipeline, which was revived in an executive order signed by President Trump. In fact, the story only gained traction once actress and anti-DAP activist Shailene Woodley mentioned it in Wednesday's interview with the website democracynow.org. It was amazing to see Malia there at this Sundance Pipeline protest. So again, instead of encouraging her fellow liberal Democrats to obey the wishes of the Standing Rock Sioux, who want them to leave, she's out there encouraging them to stay. That's why I say don't ever invite a liberal in, because you'll never get rid of them if you do. Plus, finally, Trump takes action to rebuild military, starts extreme vetting at the border. He's got an executive order to boost the military, as well as Trump has said that he is open, believe it or not, and I'll put the link in on social media and on the website, but he is open to getting rid of the Electoral College. What do you people think about that? Donald Trump wanting to get rid of the Electoral College. Hey, I'm not making this stuff up. This is something that he's willing and wanting to do, I guess. He doesn't, even after, well, it is what it is, folks. It really is. You just can't, I don't know what that means. But I guess we will soon see. Well, I guess that sound means that we're out of time for today, but we will be back here tomorrow in 21 hours. So until then, have yourselves a wonderful start of your week. I will see you tomorrow morning. Until then, I'm Rod Eccles. Thanks for listening to The Rod Eccles Show. I'm out.
Damn, it feels good to be a Clinton. Damn, it feels good to be a Clinton. A shameless politician always plays her cards right. Got a crew for the fight on the airwaves. Lap dogs in the press keep the mouths tight. Cause a Clinton never needs to explain what, why it is, what they done, or with who. A real Clinton knows that they're entitled, and you don't get to know what they do.
What difference does it make?
For Clinton, what's loaded in some fat Apple file? A Clinton plays the victim for promotion. A Clinton kills it off with a smile. Damn, it feels good to be a Clinton. A server full of secrets ain't no thing. Damn, it feels good to be a Clinton. Nothing ever hits with a sting.